Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Sell yourself first, the most critical element in every sales effort. Written and read by Thomas A. Freese. Preface. When I first sat down to write this book, the world economy was headed into one of the worst recessions since the Great Depression. Now everything seems eerily different as we realize that the field on which we work and play has changed dramatically. Even those of us who were minding our own business when the downturn began breathed a collective gasp when the 30-year era of unabated growth and prosperity seemed to collapse overnight. It's easy to sell when business conditions are consistently favorable, and for the better part of two generations, businesses, individuals, and investors alike have all enjoyed an unprecedented run of good times. As a result, the economy boomed with unrestrained exuberance, rampant overspending became an accepted part of our culture, and ravenous growth distorted the corporate mindset to the point where just a few years ago, companies couldn't hire new employees fast enough. More was definitely better. Then reality set in, and the bubble burst. Who would have thought that our financial system would require a $1 trillion bailout, or that large Wall Street brokerage houses could literally go out of business over a weekend? These factors have all come together at the same time to create a perfect storm of economic conditions that sent our previous capitalistic mentality into a veritable tailspin. More than at any other time since the Industrial Revolution began, companies in all industries are now aggressively looking for ways to retain customers, boost top-line revenues, and maintain reasonable profit margins in the process. To survive and ultimately flourish in this new economy, decision-makers at all levels within the company must re-examine the way they deal with suppliers and customers, and frankly, some of those adjustments that need to be made are long overdue. Surely I'm not the only one who thinks there have been a few times in recent history where we could have used a good kick in the pants. People are naturally concerned about what the future holds. Some of them should be. I can see it in the eyes of audience participants during some of the recent QBS training programs I've delivered. I'm not trying to be insensitive, just realistic. Economic times have changed, and I suspect that this genie isn't going back into the bottle anytime soon. That said, I am not one of those doomsdayers who runs around predicting economic Armageddon, nor do I believe we are headed for another Great Depression. We will survive the current challenges, as well as the many humps and bumps that will likely occur on the road to economic recovery. I do believe, however, that we have entered a historic period of adjustment where a Darwinian-style recalibration is now underway, where companies and individuals who are the most able to adapt to changing marketplace will have a definite advantage. Thus, how we choose to conduct ourselves in the coming months and years will likely determine where we end up when the dust settles and the current turbulence subsides. The appetite for change has never been greater. When there is plenty of business for everyone in the marketplace, company meetings tend to morph into celebratory events where sales teams congratulate themselves for a job well done. When the size of the market shrinks unexpectedly and suddenly there's no longer enough business to go around, the overall mood at these meetings abruptly shifts from congratulatory and self-indulgent to serious and even grim, overtaken by a sense of urgency to identify ways to adjust to rapidly changing market conditions. In a real-life game of musical chairs, it has become clear that not everyone will get a seat when the music stops, and even those who are able to survive the tumultuous nature of today's competitive marketplace will undoubtedly notice that the opportunities coming their way have appreciably decreased in number, size, and scope. Guess what happens when salespeople and companies begin to transact smaller pieces of business, or in some cases, are no longer getting enough opportunities to justify their existence? That's right. They tend to become perceptively hungrier and more aggressive. Basically, a competitive business person's survival instincts kick in, and struggling sellers who are not able to differentiate themselves or their products will inevitably resort to significantly discounting the prices, thus eroding profit margins across the industry. Sound familiar? This increased pressure in the marketplace comes with an ironic upside, however, and one that has sparked a renewed sense of desire within companies and, I dare say, throughout the entire sales profession. It turns out that the same people who are hungry for business are also eager for new perspective and creative ideas about what they can do differently to give themselves a competitive advantage. Never before have individual salespeople been so willing to put their egos aside and adjust their approach to make themselves invaluable to their company and their customers. Frankly, most salespeople are smart enough to realize that some adjustments are necessary with regard to how we approach and deal with clients, as it now appears that our best opportunity to get out of the current predicament is going to be to somehow sell our way out. Companies have experienced a bit of a comeuppance as well, where much of the typical squabbling and internal politics that have traditionally plagued organizations has been replaced by an all-hands-on-deck mentality. Essentially, the same perfect storm that recently stirred up so much dust in the marketplace has also fostered a perfect opportunity to recalibrate the traditional selling mindset. Updating the effectiveness of your sales force doesn't have to be as daunting as it sounds, however. It's true that some corporate training departments will need to shift their traditional focus away from continually redefining the sales process or just offering a slew of refresher courses that teach old-school content. Teaching salespeople to sound the same as your closest competitors is an exercise in futility, and anything that merits the title of refresher course is more likely to send people backward in their thinking rather than forward. Does anyone else think it's strange that the effectiveness of the sales organization drives the success of every company, yet the skills required to be successful in a sales role continue to be the least taught professional discipline in the world? Most companies rely on individual salespeople to figure it out for themselves. While some of the more experienced sellers on your team have likely attended a bunch of sales seminars over the years, teaching people how to sell in a tough economic climate is very different from what most sellers have encountered from their previous sales training experiences. Emphasis on sales effectiveness. Who should be held responsible for the recent softness in sales volume? Unfortunately, finger-pointing to assign blame has become a veritable pastime in some companies and industries. However, in sales, after you get done blaming the economy, blaming corporate marketing, or blaming the competition, and sometimes even blaming the customer, if you look around any sales organization, you will notice that some salespeople are significantly more effective than others, even though they are selling the same basic products and services to the same types of customers. What is it that makes a top-performing salesperson more effective than one of their struggling counterparts? What is it exactly that they are doing to separate themselves from the competition in a way that overcomes the adversities and grievances many other salespeople see as obstacles? It's a fair question, but very few people have the answer. I wrote this book with the intentional and unmistakable mission to increase the sales effectiveness of the person staring back at you when you look in the mirror. It is possible that the techniques and strategies outlined in this book can also help your colleagues, business partners, and maybe even your management team. Let's consider that a bonus if it happens. But the truth of the matter is, if you aspire to become a more effective salesperson, the time has come for you to take matters into your own hands. The customer's impression of you will enable or compromise the entire business relationship. Unfortunately, this topic of individual effectiveness has been pushed to the back burner for too long, and in the process, lots of good people have been caught off guard, and in some cases, are unprepared for how best to respond given the rapidly changing business environment. If it is indeed true that some salespeople in your industry are more effective than others, then I encourage you to bring your own personal selling effectiveness back to the forefront, in order to give yourself the strongest possible opportunity to be perceived as a valuable resource by your company, your colleagues, and your customers. While it's true that you still have to position your company and products in their best light, to be effective in today's economic climate, you must learn how to sell yourself first. Introduction. The game has changed. Do you realize that in the state of Georgia, where I live, you have to have a license to catch a fish or own a dog, but you can refer to yourself as a sales professional without any credentials whatsoever? It's true. Even though the sales industry will probably never be tightly regulated, customers have become very adept at spotting the differences between a salesperson who can provide a truly valuable product or service from those who are mostly focused on getting their next commission check. One of the biggest differentiators in sales is actually quite simple. Those salespeople who understand that it is important to sell yourself first will have an unfair advantage over their competition moving forward. In every competitive industry, and probably for the rest of your sales career, the person representing a product or service is likely to have a greater influence on the customer's perception of value than the product itself. For previous generations, the act of selling was often seen as the art of persuasion. In that vein, convincing potential buyers to purchase your products or services was a necessary evil, where a talented salesperson was someone who not only possessed a gift of gab, but also had an uncanny knack for getting into the customer's pocket before he or she realized they were being sold on something. Over time, many of the older school sales tricks and manipulative marketing gimmicks have now run their course, and most customers are quick to recognize the difference between someone who is truly trying to help them and someone who just wants to make a quick buck. Think about it. If someone tells you that you sound like a used car salesman, that's usually not a compliment. When I think about the concept of being professional, my mind suddenly shifts to the other end of the spectrum, far away from the traditional used car dealership. I think of the business practices of professional people like architects, attorneys, doctors, accountants, or engineers, basically people who are bona fide experts and who provide advice within their particular field of expertise. A professional could also be the gifted athlete who, with enough hard work and commitment to excellence, is able to transform some physical skill into a marketable enterprise. Either way, being seen as a true professional is not only a casual compliment, it changes the way people perceive and interact with you. The designation of someone as being a sales professional could seem like the ultimate oxymoron in some people's minds. Yet there is a vast difference between a salesperson who is a bona fide expert, offering valuable solutions, and the wheeler-dealer mentality that is often associated with more traditional selling methods. Today, I can assure you that the sales function is no longer a necessary evil. Rather, the ability to have success in selling goods and services is the lifeblood of every successful business venture. Simply put, if you cannot sell it with some degree of consistency, then it doesn't matter how good your product or service actually is. That said, the business of selling can no longer be seen as an act of persuasion. Customers don't want to be persuaded to buy something they don't want or need, especially by a salesperson they don't yet know or trust. Thus, we very quickly come to a crossroads in terms of how we, as salespeople, want to be perceived by customers, prospects, colleagues, and even our employer. Do you want to be seen as someone who is customer-focused, with valuable expertise, high integrity, and a commitment to excellence, or just as another self-serving vendor trying to get into the customer's pocket? The difference in perception usually comes down to how effective you are at positioning yourself. Boiled down to simplest terms, a sales professional is someone who is able to do two things consistently: help people and communicate effectively. It makes perfect sense that a doctor is essentially in the business of helping people. Lawyers, consultants, architects, engineers, and accountants, too, have all obtained enough expertise in their respective professions to make a healthy livelihood out of helping people, although they may not all communicate with the same level of effectiveness. Having spent the bulk of my career in the trenches of sales and sales management, and then publishing this, my fifth book on professional selling, I have had the opportunity to work with many top salespeople at some of the most successful companies in the world. In doing so, I have noticed a few common characteristics among excellent salespeople that may surprise you, starting with the fact that top performers are often not the most outgoing or gregarious people in the company. In fact, it's not unusual to find that the very best salespersons in a company or within an entire industry are often highly introspective, somewhat reserved, and in some cases, even slightly introverted. There goes the theory that the gift of gab is actually a gift. With this in mind, when you make an appointment to see a professional, a doctor of your choosing, for example, you basically want two things from them. You want them to take the time to understand your situation in order to then give you valuable advice or a viable solution. Your goals would be the same as if you met with an accountant. you would want them to understand your situation so that based on their experience and expertise, they could help you in some valuable way. Today, it's no different in sales. The only reason a customer would want to meet with a sales professional is for that person, presumably you, to invest the time to understand their situation so that you could then help them in some way, either by providing valuable advice or viable solutions. Hence, the concept of being a sales professional is actually quite simple. The challenge is you are not the only one in the marketplace who is trying to help these customers. If you sell in a highly competitive business environment, which I assume most people do, then you're not the only vendor calling these customers on a regular basis and trying to get a foot in the door. In fact, you're probably not the only salesperson who has called in the last 20 minutes. Especially on the heels of an economic downturn that some people have labeled the Great Recession, sellers who are under pressure to produce more revenue are not only making more calls, they're also being more aggressive with potential buyers. This creates somewhat of a vicious cycle where customers who don't want to be hounded by salespeople are intentionally distancing themselves from vendor solicitations. Of course, as it becomes more difficult to get the attention of key decision makers, sellers are becoming even more aggressive, which causes customers to be even more standoffish. Maybe you are not overly aggressive or inappropriate in any way. Like your prospects, I don't know you personally, but I can assure you that your target audience of potential customers has their defense mechanisms on full alert, having been jaded from the dozens of other salespeople who came before you, many of whom treat the sales function as simply a means of creating revenue, as opposed to actually helping the customer solve a problem. Still, some salespeople are significantly more effective than others, in every industry. That realization raises a very simple question. What is it that separates top-performing salespeople from their struggling counterparts? The answer comes down to two simple words: customer perception. I wish I had a nickel for every time I've seen a geographical territory get reassigned to a different salesperson, and suddenly, for some strange reason, a sales territory that was once considered an absolute wasteland turns into a virtual gold mine. Meanwhile, could it be sheer coincidence that all of the opportunities in last year's gold mine of a territory suddenly dry up when someone else with lesser skill or experience takes over? Of course, there is often some amount of luck involved when it comes to being in the right place at the right time. But in sales, you can't attribute consistent performance and maximizing one's own effectiveness to pure chance. These situations happen far too often to be brushed aside as statistical anomalies. Neither can you blame good genes, a pleasant personality, or someone's genetic makeup for having an innate knack for success or a lack thereof. I have literally met a set of twins, presumably with the same DNA, where one could sell ice cubes in the Arctic while the other couldn't give away an air conditioner on the equator. Likewise, I know some very pleasant people who are struggling mightily now that the economy has tightened and selling has become much more than a personality contest. In the end, I would argue that DNA isn't the issue at all, as I have seen countless salespeople enhance their performance and results by simply adjusting their approach, without having to alter their personality or change their genetic makeup. Some people even fault customers for their own lack of success. I can certainly empathize with the idea that blaming external factors can make you feel better in the short term, but attributing your deficiencies to external factors doesn't do anything to improve your chances of making the next sale. Given the current business climate, sellers can no longer count on their products alone to be the differentiator. The more likely scenario is that you will be one of several competitors offering viable solutions, which customers may even perceive as comparable. For example, what is the difference really between Allstate Insurance, State Farm, and Nationwide? In terms of selecting an insurance company, I suppose it comes down to whether you want to be in good hands, have a good neighbor, or you like the idea of having Nationwide on your side. From a pure product perspective, however, there are more similarities than differences between these comparable options. You might even say they're functionally equivalent. A discerning customer could easily conclude the same about the financial services industry, where you can purchase the same 100 shares of General Electric or Coca-Cola stock from any number of brokerage houses, often located within blocks of each other. Realtors within the same metro area face a similar challenge, where they are all essentially competing to sell the same inventory of homes at the same listed prices. Even the drug companies face stiffer competition as a continuous stream of new medicines and formulary alternatives continue to come on the market. When rival companies engage in a battle of buzzwords and try to outdescribe each other, comparable solutions tend to get commoditized and then often end up sounding very similar to target customers. Whenever this happens, which occurs more often than not in competitive markets, the salesperson can no longer count on the product itself for differentiation. Unless you are truly the only provider that offers a unique product or service, your competitors all claim to offer the best solutions too. Don't get me wrong, the value of your company and the quality of your products you sell are still important, but in most industries, the person representing the product or service will have a greater influence on the customer's perception than the product itself. For too long, companies have been content to arm their sales teams with some basic product training before sending them out into their respective territories to talk about features and benefits. But if you went down to the local branch office and opened a brokerage account with a financial firm like Morgan Stanley, I bet you would never meet Mr. Morgan or Mr. Stanley. Instead, your faith in the company and confidence in the products being offered would almost exclusively be the result of the impression you form as a result of your dealings with one of their 16,000 financial advisors. To a customer, the financial advisor at Morgan Stanley is the company. This same phenomena applies in most businesses, whether you sell technology, real estate, manufactured goods, pharmaceuticals, consulting services, or you are a home builder, engineer, financial planner, or franchisee. In the foreseeable future, the effectiveness of the individual salesperson will have a greater impact on customers' perception than the products and services being offered or the company he or she represents. The challenge for the salesperson who is getting ready to call on new customers is, how will the next prospective customer you call on know you're smart? How will they know that you're trustworthy, competent, knowledgeable, and experienced? Will they simply assume that you have great ideas and are a thought leader in your respective industry? How will they come to the point of understanding that you actually have solutions that could help them greatly? As salespeople, should we just tell them? Should we call potential buyers and say, "Hi, Mr. Customer, this is Joe Smith with XYZ Company, and I am the smartest and most credible salesperson you will ever meet. I also represent the finest company in the industry, and we have better solutions than anyone else. In fact, you're lucky you picked up the telephone because you're really going to enjoy talking with me." Really? Is that how we're supposed to do it? By trying to claim our own credibility? I hope for your sake that that is not reflective of your current approach to calling customers, because claims of credibility in today's selling environment tend to fall on deaf ears. Put yourself on the receiving end of that call for a moment, and I bet you would either laugh, sigh, or simply hang up in disgust. Would you agree that building credibility with potential buyers is an important step toward being successful in sales? Conveying competence, relevance, innovation, stability, quality, and value, more so than your competition, is critically important as well? While a salesperson can brag about their company and products, most of us know from personal experience that one of the quickest ways for a salesperson or any professional to turn customers off is to start bragging about themselves. Your success in business and in life will ultimately hinge on the impression other people form about you. If you sell for a living, then you are keenly aware that customers are always forming impressions of a sales caller, and the perceptions they form throughout the sales process will likely determine whether or not they choose to purchase your products and services. Thus, closely contested sales opportunities usually come down to a host of intangibles, which include a variety of attributes such as a salesperson's character, professionalism, their credibility, expertise, their knowledge, vision, helpfulness, honesty, mutual respect, customer focus, and consistency when following through on verbal commitments. Oddly enough, the extent to which you actually possess these character traits is not the issue. The primary challenge sellers now face is figuring out how to convey these important yet highly intangible qualities in order to differentiate yourself and enhance the value you bring to customers, partners, colleagues, and your management chain. It has long been the case that people tend to buy from people they like. The thing that has changed is why customers may or may not like you. If a salesperson is friendly and personable, that's definitely a plus. But in today's selling environment, the salesperson who gives customers the best advice is usually the one who wins the sale. Another way to characterize this is to say that people tend to do business with whomever makes them feel most comfortable with their solution. If you indeed represent the finest company in your industry, and you are truly offering the best solutions for your customer, you still have to be perceived as relevant, purposeful, credible, and valuable in order to earn their trust. Basically, you have to sell yourself first in order to be successful. How exactly are you supposed to sell yourself in an increasingly competitive business climate? That is what this entire book is about. As an extension of the question-based selling QBS methodology, which I have now been teaching for the past 13 years to salespeople and companies around the globe, this book was written as a direct commentary for how salespeople in today's selling environment can leverage superior technique and strategy to stand out, build more value, and essentially gain an unfair advantage over the competition just by making a few adjustments to how they choose to position themselves. My goal for this book was to create a repeatable formula for selling yourself, which extends far beyond the notion that readers will simply take a few pearls of wisdom away from the text. To become a consistent top performer, you ultimately need a repeatable system that focuses on the implementation of what I call the softer sales skills, like piquing the customer's interest, establishing your own credibility, forging and leveraging relationships, differentiating your solutions, justifying the cost, and of course, securing commitments throughout the sales cycle. I would argue that skills development has become the new field on which the game of selling is now being played. At the end of the day, customers are going to turn to someone for advice, and it's reasonable to assume it's either going to be you or one of your competitors. Hence, there is some responsibility on your part to decide how you want to be perceived, and then to be proactive enough to implement a strategy that will enable you to achieve the desired result. Does this sound too good to be true? Well, let me ask you this question. How hard do you want selling to be? If you notice, every time a sales conversation goes well, at the end of the call, the customer always thanks the salesperson for calling, coming to see them, or helping them solve a problem. We too can and should be respectful and appreciate the customer's time and participation. But every time a sales conversation goes well, what the customer is really verbalizing is their appreciation for your capacity to help them in some meaningful way and your ability to communicate effectively in the process. Contrary to many of the sales gimmicks and process models that have come in and out of vogue over the last 20 years, you don't communicate effectively by making the sales process more difficult or convoluted. You increase your effectiveness by understanding the cautious nature the typical prospect has toward vendors, where old-school sales approaches are causing prospects to become even more skeptical, and then replacing that entire paradigm of trickery with a set of proven techniques and strategies that will ultimately produce the desired improvement and results. Keep in mind that your doctor went to school and studied for 10 or more years before you were willing to take his or her advice. Likewise, it takes 5 to 8 years of formal education to become an architect, an accountant, an engineer, or an attorney. With that in mind, perhaps it's reasonable to expect that it should take a little effort and commitment on your part to learn how to cause potential customers to trust you with their time, money, problems, issues, goals, needs, and concerns. The sales profession is one of the most exciting and rewarding occupations in the world. Whenever a sale goes well, the customer gets the benefit of valuable solutions, the salesperson gets paid handsomely for making the sale and producing revenue for his or her company, and the customer thanks the salesperson for helping them. But for salespeople, justifying your value to customers and to your company is not going to be as easy as before. The fact that you are listening to this book tells me that you are committed to excellence. I must assume, however, that some of your toughest competitors are similarly devoted to their own success. Thus, even if you are indeed a capable individual, it's unlikely that you are the only talented person in your industry. Companies offering similar solutions will be competing against you harder than ever to gain the customer's trust and ultimately earn their business. Eventually, someone is going to win these battles, and as you might expect with any competitive situation, your ability to prevail has a lot to do with you. In today's competitive landscape, your long-term career aspirations, along with your day-to-day livelihood, depend on your own personal effectiveness now more than ever. And how you approach the profession of selling will ultimately determine whether you will be seen by customers as a sales professional or just another hungry vendor who's trying to make a buck. Even if you are not a career salesperson, whether you manage a small business, support the organization in a customer service role, or are an executive in a Fortune 500 company, you will definitely be selling yourself every day. On a personal note, I am grateful to have had the opportunity to share my ideas on selling with so many salespeople, managers, executives, and non-salespeople. I am also humbled by the eagerness people have shown over the years to implement question-based selling and to refer the QBS methodology and our training programs to others. Thank you for placing such confidence in me. To that end, my mantra for this book is relatively simple. When selling yourself, you must remain true to yourself by doing things in a way that makes the most logical sense in today's business climate. With all due respect to other authors and selling systems, it no longer matters what may have worked 20 years ago. In that vein, make it your goal to be perceived as competent and purposeful when talking with customers, and keep it simple and current by allowing reasonability and relevance to be your guide. Now it's time to prepare for an odyssey that will change the way you deal with customers over the rest of your sales career. With absolute confidence, I can tell you that learning to sell yourself first will also change the way customers perceive and deal with you. Chapter 1. The Elephant in the Room. Starting with an elevator pitch to convey value is officially dead as a viable differentiation strategy. After a salesperson finishes spewing all the wonderful benefits of his or her product offering, the customer's two biggest issues have not yet been addressed. What decision makers really want to know is who to trust and how to make a good decision. Even if you have a great story to tell about your products and services, customers are skeptical of sales pitches now more than ever. Thus, for the sake of maximizing your credibility and differentiating your company's value, you must be willing to give customers what they really want, the rest of the story. Customer skepticism is the elephant in the room, and you will help yourself substantially by dealing with it up front. Let me guess, your company is the leading provider of quality widgets in your respective industry, as evidenced by an impressive track record of success and unmatched innovation with a commitment to quality and excellence that is second to none. Am I close? Well, join the club. Have you been to your competitor's website lately? I bet they lay claim to many of the exact same bullet points you point out as exclusive benefits. Even if their marketing strategy was blatantly plagiarized from your company's efforts, you should not be surprised if the messages being conveyed by competing vendors sound very similar to yours, especially if you are the industry leader. Particularly in these economic times, your rivals are going to do whatever they can to suggest that their offerings are indeed more robust and valuable than yours. How do most customers perceive or interpret these self-serving claims of superiority? Well, you can easily judge for yourself just by observing a few of the many infomercials on television. On any Saturday morning, for example, with the exception of the cartoon channels and ESPN, you can flip around the dial and find wall-to-wall infomercials featuring an assortment of enthusiastic pitchmen selling everything from kitchen knives to juicers, slicers, exercise equipment, weight loss programs, and get-rich-quick real estate schemes. When the host of the infomercial looks directly into the camera and confidently says, "You too can lose up to 40 pounds in a single week without any exercise and without changing your diet," I bet your natural skepticism doesn't allow you to buy into such claims that are obviously overstated. Seriously, I wonder how many people really lose 40 pounds in a single week. In fact, today's consumer has become so jaded that product claims from any enthusiastic salesperson are likely to fall on deaf ears. Some of this natural skepticism can be attributed to recent changes in our perspective as a society. For example, let me ask you this question. Over the past few months, or even the last several years, would you say that consumers in general have become more open and receptive to salespeople they don't yet know and trust, or more cautious and reserved? As an example, When you are on the receiving end of a cold call from a salesperson, what's the very first thought that pops into your head? Do you think to yourself, oh boy, this is great. A salesperson is calling. Now I get to talk with some stranger and learn about something I don't really know. I bet you don't. If you're like most people, you probably think, ugh, not another sales caller. No matter how seedy the reputation some sellers have earned over time, it's important to note that most customers don't despise salespeople. In fact, the opposite is true. Most customers actually depend on salespeople for ideas, information, a vision into the future, and for solutions. They just don't depend on every vendor who happens to come calling, and they are reticent to take advice from someone they don't yet know or trust. As a result, good salespeople representing viable companies with legitimate products and services are being consistently fended off by gatekeepers and by decision makers themselves. Sellers are therefore finding it increasingly difficult to get appointments with key people and target accounts. It has also become more difficult to differentiate your value proposition from the last dozen vendors who called, sounding strikingly similar, and then to somehow secure a commitment to move forward either by scheduling the next step in the decision process or moving ahead with a favorable purchase decision. Even though customers have become increasingly standoffish, it's still true that whenever a sales call goes really well, I mean when the conversation goes exactly as planned, and a perfect match exists between your solution and the customer's needs, the customer always thanks the salesperson for calling. It's uncanny but true. Customers will spend all kinds of time with someone they perceive to be a valuable resource, and they are much less open to spending time with random cold callers. Not surprisingly, there is a huge difference between engaging a customer in an in-depth conversation about how your solutions will address their needs and being instantly dismissed by a reluctant gatekeeper. Sales tricks, marketing gimmicks, and anything else that might sound manipulative to customers is likely to be fended off also, as most decision makers have become pretty adept at discarding vendors who seem purposeless or lack credibility. That said, let's not be surprised when the traditional elevator pitch or taking an infomercial sounding approach to positioning the value of a product or service doesn't garner a receptive audience when you reach out to prospective customers. The next logical question that salespeople and managers tend to ask is, well, given the customer's natural skepticism toward vendors, how can we as sellers put ourselves in a stronger position to be viewed as a valuable resource and not just another cold caller? If we're honest about it, most customers will only choose to engage some fraction of the salespeople who come calling on a daily basis. Again, they don't despise salespeople. Key decision makers just aren't going to entertain the idea of changing vendors, products, or platforms every week, and they don't want to be hounded incessantly in the meantime. But even when a real live need is brewing, or where a specific project or initiative has been identified, not every salesperson is going to get a seat at the table to present their wares. Not surprisingly, most customers want to narrow the field of possible vendors down to a manageable number of viable alternatives so they can then choose from the top two or three contenders. The real question, therefore, is how often are you being selected as the person the customer wants to rely on for advice, ideas, a vision for the future, and ultimately for a valuable solution? You are more important than your product or company. If you sell in a competitive marketplace, which most people do, with the exception of where your corporate headquarters is located and how much revenue your company produced last year, there's nothing you can say at the buzzword level to a customer in the first 2 or 3 minutes of a sales conversation that is significantly different from what your competitors will probably say about their product or service. Thus, opening with a standard elevator pitch about your offerings is the quickest way to commoditize your value proposition, which is exactly the opposite result from what most sellers are attempting to achieve. Customers have heard most of the buzzwords already, and they're not likely to be impressed just because you happen to have a pleasant personality. Given that the customer's comfort level surrounding you, your company, and your solution alternatives is critically important, perhaps we should ask a simple question. What exactly can we do to make potential buyers more interested and more comfortable? It's easy to talk about how great one's company and products are, but it's a little less obvious how to earn credibility with new prospects without running the risk of sounding pretentious or arrogant. It's also a bit tricky to demonstrate important personal qualities such as honesty and integrity, or being prepared, helpfulness, responsiveness, understanding, creativity, and demonstrating mutual respect. If you could combine the true value of your offerings with other intangibles, like somehow conveying that you are indeed knowledgeable, experienced, capable, competent, and reliable, then you would have a pretty strong value proposition. In a best-case scenario, you would absolutely want customers to associate you with the desirable character traits, like perceiving you as someone who is customer-focused, empathetic, passionate, hardworking, and sensitive to the customer's specific needs, right? Add a small dose of humility together with honorable intentions, and you are either a vendor whose solution offerings are worthy of further exploration, or you are a perfect candidate for one of my daughters to marry. Most customers who make purchase decisions are simply looking for the best value. But let's not confuse being valuable with being the cheapest option or least expensive. Customers usually aren't looking for the least expensive alternative, which is good because the cheapest option is rarely the most cost-effective. Have you ever won a deal when your proposal was more expensive than other options being considered? Like any other successful salesperson, I have closed many deals over the years where my proposal was not the cheapest option. On the flip side, have you ever lost an opportunity when your proposed solution was in fact the least expensive? I have. Even today, I have no desire to be the absolute cheapest sales trainer, just the most valuable. The concept of procuring solutions from the best source is a constant challenge for decision makers because value is a very difficult concept to quantify, especially once you realize that price is only one of the many factors that affect the customer's perception of your value. Cost is always going to be an important factor, particularly these days. But if you think about it, most people don't drive the cheapest car. Most consumers don't eat the cheapest food or wear the cheapest clothes. Instead, customers today are interested in choosing whichever option provides the most value relative to their needs, which combines the perceived value of your product or service, coupled with a host of intangibles that you bring to the table. Even so, chances are good that you are not the only vendor in your industry that adds value. In these cases, where equivalent products can be purchased from equally viable competitors, as in real estate sales, where the same properties can be listed or purchased from any number of licensed real estate agents for basically the same price, you will find that customers usually don't deal with just anyone. Instead, most people choose to buy from whoever offers the most value in terms of the best service and advice. This is one area of sales that has changed dramatically over the last few years. As I mentioned in the introduction, customers tend to buy from whoever they like the best. It's just that likability is no longer just a function of friendliness and sociability. Instead, customers will like whoever represents the greatest value, which is now a function of being perceived as credible, intelligent, capable, professional, creative, honest, prepared, customer-focused, and responsive to the customer's needs. The same logic applies in virtually every competitive marketplace, whether you sell financial services, pharmaceuticals, technology, or sales training courseware. Customers are ultimately going to partner with someone in an effort to meet their needs, and whether or not they choose to deal with you has a lot to do with how you choose to deal with them. Consequently, I can tell you that the difference between winning and losing in today's business environment usually comes down to the ongoing perceptions customers form about you, the salesperson. Learning how to win when it's close. Can we agree that a salesperson's ability to gain credibility is a critical component of any successful sales effort? While gaining the customer's confidence early is indeed important, a salesperson's ability to earn some initial credibility in order to then get deeper, wider, and more strategic within their accounts can give an otherwise ordinary salesperson an unfair advantage. Potential buyers aren't just looking for a sterile listing of features and benefits when talking with vendor representatives. What they really want is to gain a certain comfort level that comes from a set of intangible benefits that don't necessarily show up on the company's pre-printed product brochures. That's because the company's brochure only tells part of the story, the shiny side, you might say. But customers know that there are pros and cons that accompany any recommended solution, so just being positive and smiley-faced is fine, but it doesn't usually satisfy the typical decision makers' need to feel comfortable. At the end of the day, they want to have some degree of confidence that they are indeed making the right decision, which includes avoiding all of the potholes and surprises that usually aren't highlighted on a company's glossy product literature or in their proposal. Discerning customers are especially looking for creative ideas, transparency, and thought leadership, the combination of which can all roll under the heading of getting sound advice. Add to these qualities the many other intangible character traits you bring to the sale, such as knowledge, experience, integrity, vision, preparedness, and responsiveness, in addition to someone who cares more about the needs of the customer than about padding their own commission check, and we may indeed be on to something. Whether the customer verbalizes it or not, these intangible qualities tend to be extremely important and will determine the outcome of many sales opportunities. When the time for decision arrives, customers want to know they are dealing with someone who cares about their long-term success, and they want to feel comfortable that you have the depth and perspective to help them make the right choice. The challenge for sellers is that your intrinsic credibility is highly intangible. While establishing one's own credibility is an important prerequisite for being successful in any sales situation, sellers can't just open their briefcases and pull out a bunch of credibility to hand to potential customers. In fact, credibility is simply a perception that other people form about you. In that sense, it's entirely possible that a salesperson can do certain things to enhance their credibility in the eyes of prospective customers, and it's also possible for that same salesperson to do things that will erode their credibility within those same accounts, if not destroy a reputation altogether. To me, the customer's natural skepticism is the proverbial elephant in the room. Consider the customer's perspective. When you are considering a purchase, you don't just want an enthusiastic pitch from a commission-hungry salesperson. What you really want to know are the pros and cons of the options available, how they would impact your business or personal needs, along with the associated costs. Oddly enough, most sellers choose to just ignore the elephant in the room, and in the face of increased customer skepticism, they continue to plow ahead with a canned product pitch full of buzzwords and accompanying glossy brochures. Do you think that ignoring a customer's issue of wanting to know the rest of the story does more to help a salesperson's credibility or potentially hurt it? If you sell in a highly competitive marketplace, it's possible that the differences between your solutions or offerings and a competitor's products are very slight, in which case it's often difficult to win the sale just by focusing on product features and company benefits. All things equal, what makes you stand out from other vendors with equivalent offerings? Still, customers who make purchase decisions are going to buy from someone. Whether or not you are able to win the close ones, when there's a virtual tie between competing vendors, has more to do with the customer's perception of what you, the salesperson, brings to the table in terms of your intelligence, your capability, your professionalism, creativity, honesty, preparedness, and responsiveness with regard to their needs. Once again, we're back to a list of highly intangible but very important character traits. As with credibility, sellers can't just open their briefcases and hand a customer a bag full of intelligence. That raises a pretty important question, and one that salespeople and managers ask themselves on a daily basis. What can I do to give myself an advantage so at the end of the day, when the customer chooses a supplier or vendor, they choose to do business with me as opposed to all of the other similar-sounding alternatives? Let's agree that it's easy to win a sale if you have a huge product advantage. For example, when someone invents a safe and affordable flying car, that product will likely sell itself. Likewise, whoever stumbles upon a cure for cancer won't need a sales organization to generate revenue for millions of eager clients. It's easy to sell a product that has no competition or is clearly different from everything else in the market. Unfortunately, that's not the reality most companies face, as sales professionals today are generally not selling exclusive products. It's more likely that you will be competing in a scenario where the customer's decision process will narrow the field of possible vendors down to a few viable alternatives, either of which could do the job. At that point, the competition between these vendor finalists has come down to a virtual tie. Without any additional differentiation from you, the customer's decision could be made by simply flipping a coin, Or the customer could just toss the proposals into the air and choose whichever vendor's paperwork happens to land face up. Granted, most customers aren't going to relegate important purchases to such random decision-making processes. Nonetheless, when the purchase decision comes down to a virtual tie between multiple vendors, someone is going to win the business, and it might as well be you. The quickest way to gain traction. The true challenge in this new economy is positioning yourself to win, given that your competitors are likely to be formidable and the sale could be won or lost by very slim margins. That said, your success as a sales professional will likely be determined by the customer's perception of the intangible benefits you bring to the table. Let your competitors be the ones who commoditize their respective value propositions with a bunch of generic buzzwords. Okay, but what happens after a sales manager gives a rousing speech encouraging reps to go out and penetrate new accounts, basically instructing them to build relationships with key people within important target opportunities? The real coaching challenge arises when one of these sales reps raises their hand and asks, "How exactly are we supposed to gain an advantage within target accounts when everyone else out there is trying to build the same relationships?" Therein lies one of the big differences between a top-performing sales professional and one of their struggling counterparts. It's the realization that an intangible benefit cannot actually be claimed by a salesperson. It must be earned. Sure, you can tell customers how great your solutions are, but your competitors are going to make similar claims about their products and company, and potential buyers will discount most of these claims anyway, just like you do when you flip past an infomercial on TV. In order to be in the strongest possible position to prevail in those opportunities that come down to a virtual tie, sellers need some way to convey important intangible benefits like credibility, experience, integrity, vision, creativity, responsiveness, and thought leadership. I would guess that we are all in agreement that these factors can be important tiebreakers. Even so, these highly intangible benefits are not something a salesperson can just claim. Take humility, for example, which is a very attractive human quality. Imagine the reaction you would get if someone was to say to you, "I am the most humble person in the world." Huh? Knowing that most buyers are natural skeptics, and we sellers are ultimately going to be judged by our actions, it's safe to assume that desirable human qualities, like humility, must be demonstrated and earned, as opposed to being claimed, to register actual value in the eyes of prospective clients. Once we conclude that winning or losing a closely contended sales opportunity could come down to the customer's perception of the value an individual salesperson brings to the table, we quickly come to a fork in the road, where you must choose to either continue onward with the traditional mentality of persuading customers that your product's benefits are different from the competition's, or step outside the box of traditional thinking and try something else that can truly give you a significant competitive advantage. What if you threw your entire industry under the bus? Although I don't always succeed, I try to be a logical thinker. In simplest terms, I consider what might make the most sense given the situation or scenario, and then I try to execute on that. Thus, my logical thought process towards selling to skeptical customers tends to work like this. It is my belief that you won't overcome a customer's natural skepticism just by being pleasant, positive, or effusive. In fact, whenever I'm the customer and a salesperson shows up who is overflowing with enthusiasm, his disposition makes him seem unrealistic, if not totally fake, mostly because people in general aren't that happy to meet me. As a result, this level of disingenuousness on the part of the salesperson causes me to be even more cautious and skeptical that their offerings can actually provide value. Like it or not, sellers inherit all of the baggage and negative perceptions that customers have formed as a result of all the interactions they've had with other salespeople who called on them long before you showed up. The good news is, the customer's natural skepticism isn't personal. They don't even know you when you first engage. Nonetheless, the customer's natural standoffishness toward salespeople is very real, and it has been formed as a result of encountering a steady stream of salespeople who were more focused on delivering their sales pitch rather than conveying a perception of real value. My perspective on dealing with customer skepticism changed within the past few months, more specifically when a commercial construction company in Atlanta hired me earlier this year to help them prepare for an upcoming industry trade show. The principal of the firm, along with most of the key players, had already devoured my first book, Secrets of Question-Based Selling, but they wanted me to come in and help them customize the QBS methodology for their specific industry, presumably to get maximum value out of their upcoming investment. We're basically a general contractor for retail office space, Mike, the CEO, told me. And you know how people feel about general contractors, don't you? Tell me, I said. Tom, lots of people have been burned by general contractors over the years, either by them cutting corners on quality, deviating from the contract, overcharging for change orders, or not following through on the promises made, he explained. Having been burned when we built the house in 2002, I could relate to some of the negative predispositions people might have toward general contractors. He added, in people's minds, general contractors are down there with used car salesmen and telemarketers. I thought to myself, if that's true, then I would want to do everything possible not to be like the last dozen or so general contractors who called or showed up presenting their ideas, only to be escorted to the nearest exit. I especially wouldn't want to sound like my closest competitors, just to have an already elongated decision process come down to a virtual tie. What I would instead want to do is figure out a way to differentiate my product and company, and most importantly, I would want to differentiate myself. Well, if we know the claims of greatness from a salesperson tend to fall on deaf ears, and we also know...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.